Good morning, friends. Say good morning. Great. My heart is filled with immeasurable joy, indescribable happiness and supreme ananda to be addressing the most intelligent students who are sitting before me in Christ University, Bannerghatta campus. It is sheer inspiration on the part of Christ University Students Forum to organize a day's program where you will be able to listen to the people who have achieved great in their lives. Just now you were able to listen to Sri Dayananda's life history, how he was able to move from medicine to a police officer. As a teacher for almost 5 decades, this thought has always been bothering my mind. Everywhere you see people making the statement that India is enjoying that demographic dividend, starting from the Prime Minister to the local politician, they always quote this fact that while the rest of the world, they are filled with aging population, India is bubbling with youthful population. More than 50% of our population in India, they are going to be in the age group 18 to 24. And that's a great asset for the entire nation. This is on one side. On the other side is, you find lots of engineering colleges churning out engineers from their programs. Lots of management schools are churning out MBAs from their programs who are immensely not employable. More than 75% of the population from the engineering colleges, they are not employable. More than 93% of the MBA graduates coming from these B schools, they are not employable. And that's a real sorry state of affairs. It reflects very badly on the way the programs are run by the colleges, universities, and the B schools and engineering institutions. So we'll have to ask the question, how do we reverse the trend? How do you make sure that these young people who are bubbling with enthusiasm in their youth, they are able to get a good employment and a job? And that's why I chose the theme for today's discussion, elevate yourselves by stepping up your skill. Actually, STEP is an acronym for skill towards employability and production, productivity, right? That's an acronym for STEP. How do you step up your skills so that you become employable, number one, and also you are able to contribute to the growth of the entire economy of the nation? Now, what are all the skills that you need to develop? I know most of the B schools, they focus on soft skills. In soft skills, you'll be mostly concentrating on communication skills, presentation skills, interpersonal skills. But I'm going to take you to a higher level. What the B schools are producing, what the colleges and universities are producing out of their portals, and what the corporate wants, there is a huge gap. Huge gap between what the corporates expect and what the academic institutions produce. So we need to understand what is this gap and how do you fill this gap. You must first understand there is a world of difference between knowledge and skill. Knowledge can be taught, skills will have to be learned. If you want to know the art of swimming, I am an expert swimmer, I give you lectures on swimming, and you read books written by expert swimmers, and one university probably in India will even give you a degree, BSc in swimming, you write an examination and get a degree, and also you would have got a distinction out of that examination. At the end of all this, if you are pushed into the waters, you will know what will happen, you will just get drowned. As you are drowning, you will throw your hands in despair and then say, I have a BSc degree in swimming from X University with the distinction, but you will get drowned. Because you know the knowledge of how to swim, but you have never practiced the art of swimming. Likewise, driving a car. If you want to drive a car, it's not enough if you know the theory of driving a car, but you must sit on the wheels and try to learn. Knowledge can be taught. Skills can never be taught, it has to be learned. You will have to take the efforts to pick up the skill. That's the first thing that we need to understand. Bloomberg, which is one of the famous consultancy institutions in the world, they have recently done a very interesting research on this gap. They have identified 14 skills. Of the 14 skills, they say, 6 skills are imparted to all the management graduates and engineering graduates across all good institutions in the world. And they are the numerical skills, communication skills, interpersonal skill, the initiative and drive. So these are the skills which are generally imparted in all the good academic institutions. And the Bloomberg studies show that companies don't look for these skills because this is taken for granted. It is, I would say, a hygiene factor, not a motivating factor. A hygiene factor is one which is there, taken for granted. If you employ a cook at home and if he is cooking, do you get thrilled? No. If you employ a driver and he is able to drive, are you getting thrilled? No, that's what he is supposed to do. You don't get thrilled when you recruit an MBA and then he is able to add the numbers, he is able to talk, he is able to make a presentation, he has the initiative and drive. These are all taken for granted. If you employ a driver and he is able to cook, or if you employ a cook and he is able to drive, you will get thrilled, right? Therefore, the company said, these are all the things that we expect from a management student. We are not thrilled. And therefore, the 6 skills that most of the B schools and academic institutions are focusing, they are taken for granted by the corporate. They are not thrilled. They have identified 2 more skills which are available but not favored by the companies. One is adaptability, the other one is work experience. These 2 skills, many of the companies, you know, they don't attach greater importance. And they have also identified other 2 skills which are scarce but companies value. But interesting point is the sweet spot. 4 skills which all the companies want, which most of the B schools and academic institutions across the globe, they are not focusing. I will just mention those 4 skills. Number 1 is leadership skills. Number 2, creative problem skills. Number 3, complex communication skills. Number 4, strategic thinking. I know in your management program, you will have a course on strategy, but that will come almost at the end of the program. Even in IIM, strategy is a course which comes at the second year, almost 5th-6th trimester. We used to have 1 course in strategy, now we have 2 courses, one on formulation, the other one on implementation. But when they say strategic thinking, from day 1, when you join an academic program, you must be able to think strategically. It is not a capstone course as a chocolate topping on the ice cream at the end of the program. No. From day 1, you must be able to think strategically. That is strategic thinking. This is what the companies want. So, the Bloomberg studies show that these are the 4 skills that are in great demand by the corporate world, but most of the B schools across the globe, they are not focusing on these 4 skills. Leadership skills, creative problem solving. So when you talk about skills, even there is a skill development corporation started by Manmohan Singh when he was the Prime Minister, and Ramadurai was the chairman. He has recently resigned, but for a long time, Ramadurai was the chairman of National Skill Development Corporation. Again, when Government of India is talking about the skills, they are talking about vocational skills. But if you look at some of the World Bank reports, they say when a country is moving from a developing country to a developed country, the kind of skills that the society requires is totally different. It is not just the vocational skills. You will have to look at cognitive skills, you will have to look at the technical skills, you will have to look at the behavioral skills. So that is one of the reasons why most of the students are not able to get a placement in the corporate when you complete your program. Probably your knowledge dimension is okay, skill dimension is okay because of the training that is given to you in the B schools. But the kind of skills that the companies require, they are at a higher level. That we need to understand. So, when a nation looks at the skills that are required for the future generation, as a matter of fact, World Bank has identified 5 skills which are required for any country which is moving up from the developing country to a developed country. They are not just vocational skill. The five skills that the World Bank is talking about is expert thinking. What is expert thinking? Today, most of the work is done by the computers. You have artificial intelligence. You have lots of things which human beings cannot do, but the computers can do. But expert thinking is that extra capability of a human being which machines cannot do. For example, diagnosing an illness. A doctor with 30 years of experience will be able to diagnose a disease despite all the reports that you have gathered. It's not just from the reports. You know, IBM as a software they have created is known as Watson. Watson is actually a medical software. If you give all the data, Watson will be able to diagnose what is the illness of the patient. Now, what Watson cannot do, some of the experienced doctors will be able to do it. That is expert thinking. Not machines can do, beyond the machines. The human intelligence can work, not artificial intelligence. The human intelligence can work and move beyond what machines are capable of doing. So, we must focus on expert thinking. Number two, they talk about complex communication. Most of the time in your soft skills, you are only trained to get an expertise in communication skills. Communication, as you all know, has a broader connotation in management. Communication is not just an ability to talk a language fluently. A communication also means you must have the ability to express the right feelings with the right words at the right time. That is communication. Most of the time we have the right feelings, but we don't express it with the right words at the right time. We are not able to do it. This I have seen when I was a teacher in St. Joseph's College. When I was a professor in St. Joseph's Ritchie, I used to teach from PUC to MPhil. When I go to a PUC class, 120 students will be seated in the auditorium. You give a talk. At the end of the talk, you enter the class and then say good morning. The whole class with a full-throated voice will say good morning, sir. And whenever I give a nice lecture, next day morning they'll come with an apple and then say, you gave a fantastic lecture on trigonometry yesterday, sir. They're able to appreciate. When you go to a BSc maths class and then say good morning, four or five feeble voices will respond and then say good morning. When I go to an MSc class and then say good morning, they'll take down, as if it is part of the subject that I am teaching, right? So, young people, when they have a feeling, they are able to express it. As you become an adult, you have a feeling, but you are not able to express. That's the problem, right? Therefore, communication does not just mean an ability to talk language fluently, but an ability to convey the right feelings with the right words at the right time. This is a very important skill which you need to possess in the corporate world. When one of your subordinate is doing a great job, you must be able to compliment him, you're doing a great job, right? Very, very important. Many a times you may have the right feeling, you may not be able to express it. But complex communication is even more difficult. You need to understand what is complex communication. Complex communication is one where you need to make sure that the internal communication within you is proper. We first think, then we speak, and then we act. First we think, then we speak, and then act. So, mano vak kayam. They should be collinear. If you think one thing, say another thing, do a third thing, there is an internal conflict already created within the individual. External people may not know that you have a conflict within you. If you think one thing and say another thing, do a third thing, there is already a conflict created within the system, within you. When you have a conflict and confusion within you, whatever you speak, that will always be containing that element of conflict, element of confusion. No matter how fluently you speak. It's very simple. M.F. Hussain may be a fantastic artist. There is a nice canvas. And M.F. Hussain dips the brush in a blue paint and starts painting. What color he will get on the canvas? Not a green color. If you have dipped the brush in the blue color, only the blue color will come on the canvas. In a similar way, if the internal communication for the individual is not coherent, is filled with conflict, whatever you speak, it will have a tinge of the conflict, it will have the tinge of the confusion and incoherence, right? So first you will have to make sure that your internal communication is perfect. Thought, word and deed must be collinear. That is precisely what our scriptures have said, manasyekam vachasyekam karmanyekam mahatmanam. We call Gandhiji as Mahatma. That single quality he had was, whatever he thinks he will speak, whatever he speaks he will do. Whatever he is doing, he will be able to speak. Whatever he is speaking, he is thinking. Thought, word and deed must be collinear. And that's not simple. That's a very great skill that we need to pick up. Unless your internal communication is strong, no matter how fluently you can speak, it can never be effective to the audience, because your internal communication is full of conflicts and incoherence. This is one of the skills that the World Bank is suggesting, that some of the developed countries will have to make sure that the young people of that nation develop this skill. Then they talk about cognitive skills, routine cognitive skills, routine manual skills, non-routine manual skills. Driving a car in Bangalore traffic, when two-wheelers can jump from any direction, that's a non-routine manual skill. It's not easy to pick up, right? Unless you have that skill of driving a car in Bangalore, you'll never be able to pick it up, right? Therefore, these are the broad five skills that we need to pick up at a higher level. Not just the vocational skills. As young people in the entire world and large numbers, you will have to make sure that you pick up all these skills so that you will be able to elevate yourselves to a better position. Now, the problem with India, as I can see, is if you look at the Europe, if you look at the American society, they have enormous faith in their own selves. An American will say that I am an American, I will be able to do anything. An European will say, I am belonging to England, I will be able to do anything. The same question if you ask, can an Indian say the same thing? Not even their parents. Faith is the basic structure for your success. If you don't have faith in your own self, even if you have faith in all the gods, in all the religions across the globe, there is no salvation for you. That's what Swami Vivekananda said. If you don't have faith in your own self, even if you have faith in all the gods of all the religions across the globe, there is no salvation for you. Now, how do you develop that faith in you? That faith you must be able to develop by looking at your own internal competencies. In Harvard University, 4 years ago, there was an international conference of directors of B-school across the globe. And this was organized by an Indian professor there, Srikant Dathar. The proceedings of the conference came out as a book. I strongly suggest to the MBA students here to read that book, Rethinking MBA. What's wrong with the management education? The outcome of that 3-day convention was, there is too much of knowing component, less of doing component, less of being component. What is doing component? The execution skills. You'll be able to sit in an AC room and plan the strategies for the company, but if you're asked to do it, you have no idea of how to proceed, right? That execution, ability to execute, is a skill that you need to pick up, which is lacking with most of the MBAs. Again, the being component, you must be able to reflect on your own internal competencies and then understand your own strengths. If you don't have that ability, you will not be able to progress at all in your life. Therefore, you need to sit and reflect as to what are all the strengths that you have, what are all the weaknesses you have. How do you get out the weaknesses? How do you strengthen your strengths? That you need to reflect and do a self-analysis. And that's precisely what is recommended in that book. It is not just enough if you pick up the knowledge, you must develop the ability to execute, you must also be able to reflect on your own internal skills. There's a beautiful verse in Bhagavad Gita which goes like this, Uddharer atmar atmanam, atmanam avasadayet, atmano atmaiva banduhu, atmano rupuratmanaha. I'll translate it in English. It says, elevate yourselves all the time. Never debase yourselves. If there is one good friend for you in the entire universe, you are your best friend. Atmano atmaiva banduhu. You are the best friend for your own self. If there is one worst enemy in the entire world, you are your worst enemy. Atmano Rupuratmana. The best friend for you in the entire universe is yourself. The worst enemy for you in the entire universe is your own self. When you become your best friend, Uddhare Ratma Ratmanam. Whenever you elevate yourselves to a higher position, you are your best friend. Whenever you debase yourselves from your position, you are the worst enemy. No one else is responsible in the entire world for either elevating yourselves or debasing yourselves. It's all done by you. So you need to elevate yourselves all the time by picking the right kind of skills so that you will become immensely employable. You will be able to contribute to the growth of the economy of this nation. You will be able to again contribute to the company for which you work. That is ultimately the purpose of most of the management graduates who are seated here. Therefore, my message to you is always constantly look at in what way you will be able to elevate yourselves so that you become your best friend by stepping up all the skills that are required in the corporate world, that are required by the society and the economy. No economy will improve because lots of young people are joining the engineering college or joining the management school. GDP will not grow because gross enrollment ratio has gone up. Today, gross enrollment ratio is going up. But still, we are not producing capable, skilled human beings. And that's a cause for concern. I am sure the people who are seated here, they are the best brains in the country. By walking this direction, you will be able to pick up the right kind of skills and you will be able to elevate yourselves to outstanding managing directors of not just Indian companies like Sundar Pichai and Nadella. You will become CEOs of some of the best MNCs in the world. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring words. We would now like to request our student representative to hand over a small token of appreciation.
Music is all about transporting people, speaking a language that languages fail to express. To speak to us regarding the beauty of this very magic, up next we have a third speaker for today, the music prodigy, Dr. Anish Vidyashankar. Extraordinary on the violin, Dr. Anish Vidyashankar is hailed as India's most melodious infusion violinist. A qualified architect, he's a creative mastermind in designs. Sir's infectious music transcends age, genre, and even nationality, and is strongly rooted in Indian traditions and classicism, yet is presented with a very contemporary global sound. From touring 27 countries, playing over 40,000 people in his home country, and big music festivals around the world, Mr. Anish has done it all. At just 26 years, Sir is one of the youngest recipients of honorary doctorate with specialization, the national level award for the best violinist, a Youth Icon Award, and even the prestigious Young Achiever Award for his music on the strings, apart from several others. Dr. Anish Vidyashankar gained his musical inspiration at the tender age of 3 from his father and guru, violinist S.R. Vidyashankar, and has been performing for a staggering 20 years now. Today, he's known as the wireless walking violinist for his unique ability to walk and play Indian musical curves on the violin. We would now like to call upon stage Dr. Anish Vidyashankar.
Check. Good morning, guys. How is all of you today? Why is everyone so dead? Come on, some more energy. Awesome. Can we have our accompanists coming on stage? Sharan Rao on the keyboards, Manjoti Bhattacharya on the guitar, and Amoga Varsha on the rhythm pads. A big round of applause for them, everyone. Can we have the... My name is Dr. Anish Vidyashankar. Can we have... Yeah, just stop at that slide. So, do you guys all have your phones with you? And you guys know that you need to turn on your flashlight at some point. Not now. So, can we have the logo, please, on the logo, the last image, please, the logo. So, without any further ado, I'd like to get started off by playing a song, and then I will come to my talk. And I think we've had some amazing people who've talked before me, and I think you can also we'll get to see some of my photos, some of my visuals that explain exactly how I've changed and adapted to different genres of music. So the first song coming up is going to be the song Closer by the Chainsmokers. So. Can we dim the hall lights, please, a bit? Yeah. To Baba Ramdev, so just the logo at the back, and let's get started.